sitting out there in the space capsule, bobbing in the water. So the captain pulled up beside it, and do you know who he assigned the job of pulling it in with the crane? A 19-year-old. Why? Because he simply did the job the best. That captain is with us tonight, and we've got stories like that. Stories like the ones that Chuck Smiley talks about, a naval aviator whose job it was to recover the astronauts Apollo 10, Apollo 13, the movie brought to mind by the event brought to mind by the Tom Hanks movie. Just another day, right, when you rescued those people?
Just another day. Just another.
You can't be telling the truth.
No, of course I'm not telling the truth. It's probably the most exciting thing that ever happens to you. My wife didn't particularly care that I made that analogy, but nevertheless, as I told someone at one point in time, the adrenaline flows so fast through your body that as you hold the stick of the helicopter, you squeeze the black juice out of the cycle.
And you also told your crew members, were you telling me the truth? To remind you of something when you got back to the deck of the ship?
Say three times, put the landing gear down.
And you did every time. We're happy to say thank you very much, Chuck. We, in addition to hearing from the crew members, are going to see a great series of reports on the history of the space program with our science editor, Brian Hackney. All that coming up at 10 o'clock. We hope you'll be with us.
Mission to the Moon. Tonight, Tom Sienkiewicz live on the recovery ship, the USS Hornet. Brian Hackney at the Chabot Observatory. Our one-hour special Liftoff to Splashdown starts now.
Thank you, Wendy. Back in the early 60s, President John F. Kennedy said, "We are going to put a man on the moon this decade." He also said, "We are going to bring them back safely." And that's where the USS Hornet comes into play. Its crew was entrusted with the responsibility of rescuing the astronauts when they splashed down. Recovering is the appropriate word. And they did their job brilliantly. We're going to hear from the men who were on board that vessel the day it happened and then the days after. And we are also going to see a fascinating history of our space program. Brian Hackney is at the Chabot Space and Science Center tonight.
Tom, thanks. This is great. I am at the Chabot Space and Science Center up in the Oakland Hills. We're getting fog coming in at this hour. It was Anthony Chabot who provided the funds back in 1883 to build this refractor. And of course, back then, they could only dream about going to the moon. In 1865, Jules Verne wrote a fictional story about a spaceship named Columbia that launched from Florida and went to the moon. As we'll see tonight, actually flying there was fraught with peril.
Standing by.
How did this happen?
We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon.
How, after 10 years of tests,
fire underneath the bird engine, lifting clean, ice coming off that redstone.
After 400,000 people had worked on it. After 20 billion had been spent on it.
Well, I have here a reservation for a flight to the moon.
Okay, all flight controllers, go, no go for landing. Retro.
Go.
Righto.
Go.
Guide, go. Control.
Go.
Capcom, we're go for landing.
How did two men wind up 200 feet above the moon, 3 miles past their landing site?
60 seconds.
With only 60 seconds of fuel left in the tank.
Down 2.5.
The whole world was watching to see if the Eagle would carry the first human being successfully to another world, or if the American space program would end like it began. Frustration, uncertainty, jubilation, tragedy. The old story of exploration was playing out above an airless world 240,000 miles from home. The story of the only time when man would first step onto another world. The story of Apollo 11.
30 seconds. Contact light.
And now live from the deck of the USS Hornet, now anchored permanently in Alameda. Good evening, everyone. I'm Tom Sienkiewicz. 35 years ago this week, extraordinary history was made. Americans walked on the moon and then came home safely. Astronauts Armstrong, Aldrin, Collins landed in the Pacific Ocean, 825 nautical miles southwest of Hawaii. This ship, the USS Hornet, was there to recover them. And they did their jobs brilliantly. You look at the history books, yes, it happened in 1969. You talk to the crew here, you'll find that it actually happened yesterday. Let's take an elevator ride down right now to the hangar bay. We're going to talk now to some of those crew members after we take an elevator ride that proves that the USS Hornet is still shipshape. The USS Hornet, of course, now is a museum, and the director of that museum is Bob Fish. Bob, thank you for hosting us tonight.
Hi, Tom. Welcome aboard.
Thank you very much. We know that the ship was decommissioned in 1970, just a year after Apollo 11, but it did have an extraordinary history before then, did it not?
It was commissioned in 43. It went to war in 1944. During World War II, it won 9 battle stars. It was in a lot of action for 15 months continuously in the Pacific theater.
And now it is a museum. Let's walk this way and let's talk a little bit about that. 7 days a week you're open?
We're open 7 days a week, 6 days with guided tours, and on the seventh day people are free to just wander around.
And what will people see when they come here?
Well, hundreds of volunteers have worked for the last six years, to restore the ship and many of the compartments, such as the bridge, the combat information center, the medical facilities, and so on. So there's a lot of great things to see on the ship itself, as well as the exhibits, aircraft.
And I suppose, a lot of people, I suppose, are just overwhelmed by the vastness of this place.
This is a big ship, 900 feet long and 42,000 tons of displacement.
All right, and you are getting a reputation now as a great exhibit of the old Apollo program. Are you not?
Well, Tom, as you know, we recovered Apollo 11 and Apollo 12 in 1969, so we are really making some headway in the space exploration museum area.
This is new to the museum. Is this the prototype for the Apollo capsules?
This is a Block 1 command module that actually was built, one of the first capsules ever built. This particular one flew a suborbital flight in 1966 and was recovered by the Hornet near Wake Island.
Compared to our technology today, you'd look at this and think it's somewhat of an antique, wouldn't you?
Yes, it looks pretty dated.
Yeah. All right. Bob, thank you. But compared to the initial days of America's space program, maybe this doesn't look so old. Brian Hackney has that for us live at the Chabot Space and Science Museum.
Thank you, Tom. And just that, you know, you're showing us around reminds me, I really have to get to the USS Hornet because that does look fascinating. It is the measure by which every other seeming impossibility is measured. You know, they can send a man to the moon, but they can't make a light bulb that lasts, or they can't balance the budget, or they can't lower taxes. For that matter, we can't send a man to the moon anymore. But there is no doubt that when the dust settles from our own civilization, that what this nation did in the 1960s, nothing like it had ever been done before. It has not been equaled since, and it will never be forgotten.
They're all that remain of the seven wonders of the ancient world, fashioned out of the dust of the desert. The Great Pyramid is the largest monument ever constructed. It took 400,000 Egyptians to build it. It took 10 years to finish. The Apollo program. It took 400,000 people to design. It took the decade of the 60s to build. The impression it made on another world will easily outlast the species that built it. And it all began in 1957 with a 23-inch aluminum ball. It was a bolt from the blue. We were beaten, and we knew it. October 4th, 1957, the Soviets use an ICBM to lob Sputnik into orbit. Its four antennas broadcast a 1-watt radio signal. In Texas, a city councilman immediately submits a motion to make it illegal for it to fly over his city. For the first time, people look up and see a man-made satellite. And the men who made it are Russian.
It is quite possible that an aggressor nation that dominates space will then dominate the world. We just can't let that happen.
Well, that's the reason that we really got the program going so well, is because the people in this country thought that the Russians were ahead of us.
Official Soviet film.
And, of course, the Russians were ahead of us.
President Eisenhower created NASA in 1958 in direct response to the Soviet advances. But the U.S. space program just couldn't seem to get off the ground. The fact that a complicated mix of kerosene and oxygen-fueled rockets crashed and burned wasn't so surprising. What was unbelievable was that in 1959, the U.S. found seven men to sit on top of them.
These ladies and gentlemen are the nation's Mercury astronauts.
They were all military test pilots. They were all between 25 and 40, all under 5'11". They were all medical experiments.
Well, roll my breakfast, 'cause I'm hungry.
They wanted to see if man could survive in space.
I said, shake, rattle, and roll. I said, shake, rattle, and roll.
As much as their physical endurance was put to the test, Mercury astronauts also had to live with two psychologists. They had to answer the question, who am I, in 20 different ways. They were given a blank sheet of paper and told to describe what they could see in it. Pete Conrad retaliated by turning the paper around. It's upside down, he said. It was easy to see the U.S. space program was getting up to speed. But up to speed wasn't fast enough to catch the Soviets. April 12th, 1961, 5:30 a.m. Moscow time. Yuri Gagarin is awakened from sleep in a small cottage near Russia's Baikonur launch site. He kisses his comrades goodbye. He climbs to the top of a modified ICBM. His pulse rate before launch is 64 beats per minute. It had taken Ferdinand Magellan's ships 3 years to circle the globe. Yuri Gagarin did it in 90 minutes. He is the first man in history to experience two sunrises in one day. He will become the first man to orbit Earth.
This is the end of an uncomfortable day for the great mass of Americans as much as for President Kennedy and his associates.
Tired of being, saying the United States second, what is the prospect that we will surpass Russia in this field?
However tired anybody may be, and no one is more tired than I am, it is a fact that it's going to take some time, and I think we have to recognize it.
Today, no matter how you add things up, today belong to the Russians.
President, don't you agree we should try to get to the moon before the Russians if we can?
If we can get to the moon before the Russians, we should.
If I were guessing today, I would say that the race for us a 50-50 bet between us and Russia.
3, 2, 1, ignition, liftoff.
Lifting clean. Ice coming off that
23 days after the Soviets, we lobbed Alan Shepard into space for only 15 minutes and 22 seconds. But a U.S. rocket had finally burned into space instead of roasting on the pad. And the country went wild. It was only 18 days after the Bay of Pigs took the U.S. to a humiliating low. Alan Shepard took the country 116 miles high. No wonder just 20 days later, John Kennedy asked Congress for the moon.
I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal before this decade is out of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the earth.
It had been only 58 years since the Wright brothers powered a flight for 12 seconds. Now we would have only until the end of the 60s to build a rocket 40 times bigger than the one that launched Alan Shepard to reach a target 2,000 times farther away.
But why, some say, the moon? Why choose this as our goal? And they may well ask, why climb the highest mountain? Why, 35 years ago, fly the Atlantic? Why does Rice play Texas? We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon. We choose to go to the moon in this decade and do the other thing. Not because they are easy, but because they are hard.
People watched the launch of the first American into orbit. All of our flights up till now had been on missiles converted from wartime use. Now we would have to design the most powerful machine the world had ever seen. We would have to amass 400,000 of the most skilled people on Earth. There was no doubt that in 1961, the United States aimed for a goal that was way over our heads. We would have 8 short years to hit it.
I'm Tom Sinkovitz, live on the USS Hornet. When we come back, the saga of America's race to the moon continues. And welcome back to the USS Hornet. My guest right now is an author and a man whose voice many of you are going to recognize. He was the voice of Apollo 11 and several other Apollo missions as well. Don Blair, it's good to see you,
Tom.
Person, because I've got to tell you, as a young Marine in Vietnam in 1969, I listened to you on the Mutual Radio Network.
That's amazing, because we were worldwide, as you probably
sure
know.
Sure were, yes indeed.
And if you got radio for this particular event, you were stuck with us.
You had the assignment of a lifetime, didn't you?
We sure did.
About July 1969. You are on the deck of this vessel. Tell us about that.
On the 06 level, we had four correspondents, three for television, and Ron Nesson, Dallas Townsend, and Keith McBee had open microphones so they could make comments anytime to help one another at three different positions on the ship. Yeah. I found my typical favorite spot after three missions. It was my fourth, up on the 06 level, which for your viewers is four flights above the flight deck.
Yeah.
It's a great catbird seat to be in.
Oh, I'll bet it was. Now, you were on the air for hours.
Four and a half hours. Yeah.
Several commercial breaks, but that's a lot of...
We took a lot of open breaks, We'd tell the stations we'll be back in 10 or 15 minutes until we had some real reporting coming from outer space, like they're 50,000 feet up or whatever, and then we'd come back with a package, and we had a sign-out line and go away for a few minutes, take a break. But the thing that started the day that day, Tom, was the whirling blades of the Nixon helicopter out of the twilight.
Let's talk about that in just a couple of minutes. Don't go away, because I know you've got more stories to tell. We talked about the early days of the space program. Now let's move to the Apollo program. Again, Brian Hackney at Chabot.
Tom, very good, and nice to meet Don, however, by remotely, nevertheless. I've got to tell you, boy, have I got the seat I was born to be in. I am sitting in the observer's chair here at Chabot Space and Science Center. Dave, can you show him this? A beautiful telescope was built back in 1915, a 20-inch refractor, that's the diameter of the objective lens, and it's gorgeous. And back when it was built, it was state-of-the-art. That's about how close people could get to the moon by looking at the eyepiece. Today, the technological rage is probably the Internet, or the ability, I suppose, to talk nonstop on a portable phone. One giant leap for mankind, I suppose. But the modern rage in the 60s was space. The sky was the limit, and oh, the benefits. In that respect, people haven't changed a bit.
So many people nowadays are concerned with weight watching and how to go on diets. Might be nice just to go to the moon and sense that feel of weightlessness without all the effort.
By 1967, the space program had taken on a lighthearted tone.
If I ever go to the moon, I think it'll be very fun.
It looks so easy. Seems like anybody could be an astronaut. It all changed here on January 27th, 1967. The last day in the lives of Gus Grissom, Ed White, and Roger Chaffee, the astronauts of Apollo 1. They were rehearsing the final 3 hours of the launch day countdown. The astronauts were inside that capsule. The hatch was closed, the capsule pumped full of pure oxygen, and then the trouble began.
You copy? No, I didn't read your check at all. I can't read your check. You want to try the phone?
First, they couldn't hear each other. Then, at 6:31 p.m., somewhere in the 700 miles of command module wiring, something sparked. Roger Chaffee yells, "Fire!" Then, "We've got a fire in the cockpit!" Then, "We've got a bad fire! Get us out! We're burning up!" The last recorded sound from the Apollo 1 capsule is a scream. Gus Grissom was one of the original Mercury astronauts. Ed White was America's first spacewalker in 1965. Roger Chaffee had never been in space before. The quest for the moon came with a deadline.
I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal before this decade is out.
But now it was 1967. Time was running out. 1,300 changes had to be made to the Apollo capsule before it could be tested again. But the Soviets scored with a successful test launch of their own rocket. And there's no doubt they would have gotten there first if we hadn't captured the best rocket scientist of all. His V-2 rocket rained death and destruction on London in 1944. Werner von Braun dreamed of space, but his modified rockets were used for war. The eventual plan hinged on a command module that would house the astronauts, an ungainly LEM, a lunar module that would ultimately touch down on the moon. It would also need something gargantuan to get it there. The answer was the Saturn V rocket. It's 36 stories high. It weighs 6.2 million pounds. It is made of 3 million parts, and yet the grease from a single thumbprint could cause an explosion. It's Wernher von Braun's dream, the most powerful machine on Earth. And until November 9th, 1967, it had never flown before. Everything would have to work on this first launch, and it was fraught with peril, because this was rocket science.
All the second stage tanks now pressurized, 35 seconds and counting.
The rocket steams with 500,000 gallons of fuel. 30 seconds before launch, two lower service arms swing back.
T-minus 15, 14, 13, 12.
9 seconds to launch, igniters fire.
We have ignition sequence start.
Five F1 engine bells fill with flame.
The engines are on.
Flame detectors vacuum away the 1,900-degree plume. 30,000 pounds of liquid oxygen and kerosene are consumed every second, building up 7 million pounds of thrust.
Four, three.
Tons of ice shower down and mix with clouds of fire.
Two, one.
If the engines are burning evenly, an internal computer sends a signal. Four 20-ton hold-down clamps release in the same millisecond. 36 stories of Saturn rocket is now riding on pure flame. Hydraulics are explosively released. Five remaining swing arms, 25 tons each, must retract in seconds. And the largest rocket in the world rises.
Zero. We have commenced.
We're go, flight radar.
And all the while, the Soviets have a secret plan of their own. CIA photographs show the Russians have built two massive rockets 1,500 miles southeast of Moscow. They launch one in the autumn of 1968. The turtles and flies on board will become the first life forms to orbit the moon. The worry now is that the Soviets will simply send cosmonauts to orbit the moon and claim to have won the space race. Now, NASA makes what Director Chris Kraft calls the boldest decision in the history of the space program. The mission of Apollo 8 is suddenly changed. It won't just orbit Earth. Apollo 8 will be the first manned mission to circle the moon. Liftoff is 4 days before Christmas, 1968.
We have commenced.
On board are Jim Lovell, Bill Anders, Frank Borman.
Where's the enter button?
3 hours after launch, they do something no astronaut in space has ever done before. They ignite a Saturn IV-B rocket.
And we see a real display now.
The long burn sends them to the moon.
All right, Houston, looks like a good cutoff.
Outside their porthole, they see something no astronaut had ever seen before. The Earth actually receding. On Christmas Eve 1968, another burn puts Apollo 8 into an orbit 60 miles above the lunar surface. The crew become the first in mankind to see the far side of the moon.
Fantastic. Hey, I don't see a thing. Where are we? Looks like a big beach down there.
They are now about to record one of the legendary images of the space program. The following is audio recorded at the moment they become the first humans to see Earth rise.
Oh my God, look at that picture over there. There's the Earth coming up. Wow, is that pretty? Oh, that's a beautiful shot.
Television now.
Apollo 8, Houston, we just got it. Okay, Apollo 8, we have a good picture.
Where were you on Christmas Eve, 1968, in the age of Aquarius, with an unpopular war raging? As we fell into discord on Earth, three astronauts read from the book of Genesis to an American television audience live from the moon.
In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. And the earth was without form, and there was light. And God saw the light, that it was good. And God divided the light from the darkness. And from the crew of Apollo 8, we close with good night, good luck, a Merry Christmas, and God bless all of you on the good earth.
Live again on the USS Hornet. Don't go away. When we come back, history is made. Neil Armstrong takes one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind. And now back live to the USS Hornet with the voice of Apollo 11, Don Blair. Boy, that sounds good on the old resume, doesn't it?
35 years ago.
Yeah, I'll say.
I can't believe it.
Yeah, what a juxtaposition to look at Vietnam and see the quagmire we were in there.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
Then to see this extraordinary marriage of science and technology just lifting our spirits.
I know, at a divided country, looking for a high, looking for a lift, and this was everything at the right time.
Yeah, we sure did.
After the disaster on the launch pad, yeah. We got our act together, and in a year and a half, they were back in the air, and we were on the moon.
Let's go back to that day when they brought the Apollo astronauts aboard this vessel. You're trying to sleep that night after a long day of broadcasting. You can't sleep. What happens?
Well, I couldn't sleep, Tom, so I took my cameras, and I came down here from my cabin right to this trailer, the MQF, and I thought, is there anybody awake at this hour? And there was one human being in that living room, and it was Neil Armstrong. And I walked up close to the trailer, and by gosh, the guy is standing there playing a ukulele. And I didn't know that, but I pushed my lens up to obliterate that window.
Yeah.
And I got a picture, which is in our book,
of
Neil playing the ukulele. And I thought, that's a nice thing to do when the night you get home from the moon.
Isn't that something?
And the pictures, the lights over his head were softened because I didn't use flash. I used fast black and white. And I wrote in the book, I said, isn't that appropriate that it was halo-like over this man's head, considering where he just came to us
isn't
from?
Isn't that something? You bet. You bet. All right.
And I sent him a copy of that picture.
Don, thank you very much.
You bet you.
And
thank
that
you.
Quarantine facility that Don's talking about, we'll take a tour of a little bit later on. Well, Brian Hackney has now set the stage. We're ready for the flight of Apollo 11. Brian?
You bet, Tom. In fact, you can say all their names in one breath. Neil Armstrong, Chuck Yeager, Charles Lindbergh, fabulous men, legendary men. And yet if Apollo 1 proved anything, the fire on that launch pad showed that we were doing things for the first time. Every step was potentially deadly. In fact, if it hadn't been for last-minute heroics, you wouldn't know the name Neil Armstrong at all. But he becomes the linchpin of our story as our nation races toward the moon in the flight of Apollo 11.
It's May 6th, 1968. Today, Neil Armstrong will come within precisely 1 second of going up in flames. He's going to practice flying the lunar module, the craft that will land on the moon. But there's no way to fly the actual craft in Earth gravity. The LEM is so fragile that you could easily poke a hole in it with a pencil. So astronauts fly this simulator. But when Armstrong lifts off, a fuel tank malfunctions. Armstrong fights to control the simulator, but it's a losing battle. Armstrong is ejected. His parachute opens late, but soon enough to cushion his fall. If you watch what happens again, you can see Armstrong eject right there, precisely 1 second before the simulator crashes and burns. Armstrong
walks away with minor injuries. Now for the U.S., the great day had arrived. A million people packed the space coast of Florida, and everyone, from former President Lyndon Johnson to Johnny Carson and Ed McMahon, had come to watch. 14 years after he explained rocket science to a network audience, the architect of the Saturn rocket watched with binoculars from launch control, while the three men who would fly that day had a breakfast of steak and eggs. Michael Collins, Buzz Aldrin, Neil Armstrong. Down the hallway, into the waiting transfer van, the drill of going up the launch elevator practiced countless times. But this time, it would end with a landing on the moon.
All the second stage tanks now pressurized. 35 seconds and counting. We are still go with Apollo 11. 30 seconds and counting. Astronauts report it feels good. T-minus 25 seconds. 20 seconds and counting. T-minus 15 seconds. Guidance is internal. 12, 11, 10, 9. Ignition sequence start. 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. All engine running. Liftoff. We have a liftoff. 32 minutes past the hour. Liftoff on Apollo 11.
The rocket burns 26,000 pounds of fuel every second, and in just 50 seconds...
Altitude's 2 miles.
It's already 2 miles high.
This is Houston. You are go for staging.
Within 3 minutes...
Staging. And ignition.
Apollo 11 is traveling at 9 times the speed of sound.
We got skirt step.
Roger, we confirm skirt step.
Okay, 11, we have a picture. We see the Earth right in the center of the screen, over.
Roger, how am I coming through now, Charlie?
Roger.
It'll be a 3-day trip for the astronauts on their state-of-the-art ship.
You can probably see this. Shrimp cocktail meal.
This computer up above my head has a 38,000-word vocabulary.
The capsule itself was traveling at 24,000 miles per hour, and the world down below wasn't exactly sitting still.
There is still, of course, a war in Vietnam. A hearing for Senator Edward Kennedy will be held in Edgartown, Massachusetts tomorrow. And Montreal beat the New York Mets 3-2 in the first of their 2 games.
3 days out, we're nearly at the moon. The burn to go into orbit worked perfectly. Buzz and Neil have climbed into the lunar module. Michael Collins stays behind in the command module. He feels that there's only a 50-50 chance that he will see Buzz and Neil alive again. When the lunar module separates from Apollo, it becomes the Eagle.
Roger, how does it look?
The Eagle has wings.
Roger.
The Eagle is in orbit around the moon. Now, it's time to land on it.
I had sweaty palms down in the console, but from a standpoint of nervousness, no, we were ready to go.
Legendary flight controller Gene Kranz had been there since the Mercury flights.
I knew this was going to be a historic day. And I pulled my controllers off on a private communications loop. And I talked to them about our team. I talked about the training. I talked that we were meant for this day. We came into this room as a team, and we will leave as a team. And that's exactly the way we played it all the way down to the surface.
Okay, all flight controllers, go, no go for landing. Retro.
Go.
Righto.
Go.
Guides.
Go.
Control.
Go.
Capcom, we're go for landing.
The LEM initiates powered descent and begins to drop like a rock toward the surface of the moon.
Still looking very good. Here go.
Eagle is within 35,000 feet of the surface when suddenly...
Program alarm.
An alarm pops up the astronauts had never seen before. It meant that their primary guidance computer was getting more data than it could handle. They were chewing up altitude at 150 feet per second, and Neil Armstrong wanted an answer.
Give us a reading on the 1202 program alarm.
It took controllers 10 seconds to make a decision.
Roger, we got you. We're going at alarm.
Then, it happened again.
Roger, 1201 alarm.
Armstrong later said that if it had been a simulation, they probably would have aborted.
We're go, flight. Okay, we're go. We're go, same type, we're go.
They were dropping below 2,000 feet.
2,000 feet, 2,000 feet.
Ignoring the alarm meant that while they could land, they might not have a good computer for liftoff the next day. And still the alarms were popping.
Roger, 1202, we copy it.
Distracted by the alarms and having gotten too strong a push when the Eagle left Columbia, they were also overshooting their landing target.
It had been a battle all the way down. We had problems with communications, we had computer problems, navigation problems. And as we got close to the surface, we were running out of fuel.
Now Neil Armstrong takes manual control of the lander and hears
60 seconds.
That meant there was only 60 seconds of fuel left. They're still 100 feet up.
100 feet, 3.5 down, 9 forward.
Still Armstrong is moving forward, not down. Controllers are sweating bullets.
Forward.
Finally, he sees a smooth surface. He slows the descent and hears
30 seconds.
30 seconds of fuel left. 35 feet high.
At about the time that I was hearing 15 seconds, we got the indications that the crew was going through engine shutdown.
Picking up some dust. Okay, engine stop. We copy you down, Eagle. Listen, Tranquility Base here. The Eagle has landed.
That was the first time many of us took a breath for those last 2 minutes.
Roger, Tranquility. We copy you on the ground. You got a bunch of guys about to turn blue. We're breathing again. Thanks a lot.
It had come at a cost of $20 billion. It had also cost 20 lives, both Soviet and American. That same night, flowers appeared on John Kennedy's grave with a note attached. Mr. President, it read, the Eagle has landed. It is now Sunday evening in the U.S.
What's happening now up there is that at this point, Armstrong and Aldrin are scheduled to, and we have every reason to think they are, eating dinner like millions of other Americans. So, who can imagine any more unusual place for two Americans to have dinner than on the moon at this point?
On board the Eagle, the astronauts have a scheduled 4-hour rest period, but they move the time for their moonwalk up by an hour.
Be advised now that the men are going to walk on the moon tonight, so better not plan to be anywhere very far from the television set at approximately 8 o'clock Central Daylight Time, 9 o'clock in the East.
Neil Armstrong is trying to think of something to say when he does step out.
Well, actually, I didn't worry about it until after landing because I guess in my own view, we didn't have that good a chance of completing a successful landing.
This Neil, radio check.
Neil, this is Houston, loud and clear. Break. Buzz, this is Houston. Radio check and verify TV circuit breaker in.
7 hours after they land, the hatch opens.
And we're getting a picture on the TV.
You got a good picture, huh?
The largest television audience in history watches as Neil Armstrong steps out.
How am I doing?
You're doing fine.
It's 7:56 p.m. Pacific Daylight Time, Sunday night, July 20th, 1969.
I'm going to step off the limb now.
Neil has his right hand on the ladder. He will step down with his left foot.
That's one small step for man. One giant leap for mankind.
Only bombardment of micrometeorites will finally fill Armstrong's boot print. It will survive here for 2 million years.
I'll step out and take some of my first pictures here.
Armstrong is moving around now, getting panoramic shots.
Okay, gonna get the contingency sample there. Right.
He scoops up a sample of soil in case they have to leave quickly.
I'll try to get a rock in here.
They will only have 2 hours and 31 minutes on the surface, but they do take a minute to look around.
Oh, that looks beautiful from here, Neil.
It has a stark beauty all its own. It's like much of the high desert of the United States. It's different, but it's very pretty out here.
They've gathered 47 pounds of rocks and set up experiments to catch solar particles and monitor moonquakes. And just as they had landed on the moon in a vehicle that had never been flight tested before, now they'll have to take off using an engine that would have to work perfectly, or Neil and Buzz would be there still.
It's one of those things where it either worked or didn't work. And it had never really been demonstrated.
Roger, understand. We're number one on the runway.
Despite the fact it had never been fully tested before.
Very smooth.
It worked perfectly.
Very quiet ride. There's that much bigger out there.
The Eagle reached Columbia 60 miles high for docking.
Okay, Mike, I'll try to get position here, and then you got it.
reunited aboard Columbia, rocketed back to Earth, the crew had one final hurdle, surviving a re-entry so hot it would fry the service module. Don't worry, the astronauts aren't aboard that. They're inside this, watching the superheated air outside their capsule. And down below on the USS Hornet, they're waiting to make contact.
11 Hornet, what's your splashdown error? Over.
There it is. That tiny dancing light is Apollo 11. They lifted off by rocket and on July 24th landed by parachute.
This was a great time for America. We felt privileged and proud to be part of the team that would make this happen. And we thanked our country every day that they gave us a chance to participate in this spectacular adventure.
What a story. When we come back after the dramatic splashdown of Apollo 11, the USS Hornet swings into action. So now, the Apollo 11 capsule is in the water about 825 nautical miles southwest of Honolulu. 13 miles away is the USS Hornet. And the man in command of that vessel is Admiral Carl Seiberlich. Admiral, thanks for being with us tonight. You had recovered capsules before, but never a moon mission and never with moon rocks aboard. What were the special concerns about that?
Well, I think the most important thing was to ensure that the ship, the crew, and the president were protected from the so-called moon germs, and to ensure that the procedures that we used would get the job done.
We're going to show a little bit of video as we continue our conversation. So what were some of the procedures that were decided upon?
Early on, after it was decided that the moon germs were a real thing, the decision was to take the astronauts out of the capsule but leave the moon rocks in, and this was done for the safety of the astronauts. So therefore, the most important thing for the protection was the biological isolation garments and the fact that we would utilize the betadine and the other chemicals to ensure the moon germs were eradicated.
If there was some concern ever about the fact that there might have been contamination aboard that ship, what were your orders?
Lieutenant Handelberg is now transferred.
Well, I had planned, if there were, I didn't have any orders, to be honest, to talk to Houston, and then working with Dr. Salkin and John Stonecipher, make recommendations to them of what we should do based on the medical doctors that we had aboard.
Mm-hmm. And now you have the three astronauts aboard, so let's take a look at the fact they came aboard on the helicopter. You brought them down to this particular deck. We're sitting in the area basically where they got off the helicopter. There's the helicopter right there, going down in the same elevator that I rode at the top of this program. And there's our helicopter. You were there for this occasion. Excited?
Oh, I really felt very strongly that, again, we had to ensure the proper handling of the so-called moon germs and be sure before the president came down that the astronauts were in the facility and that the moon germs had been eradicated.
Okay, and very, very briefly, President Nixon on board your vessel, so you obviously had to be in ship shape, wanted to shake hands with the astronauts.
That's correct.
I told you that, and you said?
I said, Mr. President, if you shake hands with the astronauts and get contaminated with the moon germs, I'm going to be in a world of trouble. And he said, I wouldn't want that to happen to you. So he stayed up on the bridge until we completed what you've seen there.
Good for him. Admiral Carl Seiberlich, thank you so much.
Thank you very,
for joining us tonight.
Much.
We do appreciate it.
Thank you.
We'll visit that mobile quarantine facility when we come back.
Anybody have a last word? How about
promotion? Do you think we could arrange something? Well, visit the USS Hornet. You don't have to wonder where history was made. You saw Neil Armstrong get off of that helicopter once he was on board. Look here on the floor. These are his steps as he walked across the floor, the first man on the moon, and walked over here to the mobile quarantine facility. This is a place where the astronauts, after 10 days in their cramped space capsule, climbed aboard this facility. And of course, the objective was to keep them from being contaminated or from contaminating anyone else. This is John Stonecipher. He essentially wrote the book on this quarantine facility. John, can I have a seat?
Certainly.
What was the objective when this was designed?
Well, as you know, no one knew what was up there on the moon. No one knew what was coming back. We were concerned that there may be harmful pathogens that would be brought back into the Earth's atmosphere. And we were concerned about contaminating the oceans, contaminating the air, contaminating the rivers, the lakes, the crops, etc. So we had to design a system that would protect the Earth from any harmful pathogens that would come back from the moon.
So they spent 4 days here. Let's take a quick tour of this facility. So we had three full-grown men and a couple of staffers in here with them?
Right. We had volunteers, a volunteer doctor from NASA, and a volunteer engineer to operate all the systems. The doctor conducted the medical examinations and was here in case any of them got sick after they came in here.
All right. Well, the president wanted to pay a visit to the astronauts who were already in here, and in fact, that night he did. So let's take a look at that.
I can tell you about all the messages we received in Washington. Over 100 foreign governments, emperors and presidents and prime ministers and kings, have sent the most warm messages that we've ever received. They represent over 2 billion people on this earth, all of them who have had the opportunity through television to see what you have done. And then I also bring you messages.
It would be a window just like that. This is actually the mobile quarantine facility used by Apollo 14. It is an exact replica of that used for Apollo 11. John Stonecipher, thank you so much, sir,
You're
for
quite
being
welcome.
With us tonight.
Thank you.
We'll be back in just a minute. It is hard to believe that 35 years have passed since those extraordinary events of July of 1969, and what a thrill it has been to hear the stories from the people who were involved in this mission and to find out that there is so much more to know about Apollo 11. Brian, your impressions, having worked for weeks putting together your stories on the space program.
Well, it reminds me of when I was that big and watching it along with a billion other people on Earth. I'll tell you the footnote to all this, Tom, is that on Tuesday the House voted to cut funding for NASA by $1 billion. We might have a mission to get to Mars, but we don't have any way to pay for it now. Arthur C. Clarke was once asked what he thought was the most remarkable thing about the moon landing. He said the most remarkable thing about it was the fact that we went there and we never went back. Tom?
Indeed. Brian Hackney, thank you very much. And we thank you for being with us tonight. I want to bring a couple of things to your attention. There is a book. Remember, we talked with Don Blair tonight, the voice of Apollo 11. His book is called Splashdown. It is a fascinating account of our space program as well. And An Evening with Alan Bean, the astronaut Alan Bean. Tickets still available for Sunday night here on the USS Hornet. Visit our webpage. Thank you so much for being with us tonight. Good night.
And to all the other people that are listening and watching tonight, God bless you. Good night from Apollo 11.